الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. قال علي بن المديني: لم يرى البخاري مثل نفسه. وقال الإمام ابن خزيمة: ما تحت أديم السماء أعلم بحديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من محمد بن إسماعيل. وقال الإمام المسلم للإمام البخاري: أشهد أن ليس في الدنيا مثلك. My respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The great master of hadith, Imam Muslim, addressed Imam Bukhari and said to him, أشهد أن ليس في الدنيا مثلك. That I testify there is nobody on the face of this earth like yourself. The genius Ali ibn al-Madini, he said, لم ير البخاري مثل نفسه. That Imam Bukhari rahimahullah has never seen anybody like himself. The great master, Al-Imam Ibn Khuzayma, he said, ما تحت عديم السماء أعلم بحديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من محمد بن إسماعيل. That there is nobody who knows the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam better than Muhammad ibn Ismail, better than al-Imam al-Bukhari. My brothers and sisters, who was this Imam Bukhari? Who was Muhammad ibn Ismail? For those of you who have never heard the name Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari, for those of you who have never heard about Imam Bukhari, very simply, we Muslims believe the Quran is the primary source of Islamic law. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are the secondary source of Islamic law. We the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe that the most authentic book after the Quran, the most authentic book of a hadith, is the book Sahih al-Bukhari, compiled by the great Imam Muhammad ibn Ismail or al-Imam al-Bukhari. Let us take a dive into his lifestyle and let us learn what made him one of the greatest masters of hadith of all time, if not the greatest. What made him Amir al-Mu'mineen fi al-Hadith, the master of the believers in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Imam Bukhari was very fortunate. From the day this great Imam was born till the day he died, Allah bestowed special blessings and favors on Imam Bukhari. To begin, very special household was chosen for him. His father Ismail was a great master of hadith. And had the honor of meeting the great Hanafi Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak. There have been very few households in history in which the father and the child were masters of hadith. Imam Bukhari rahimahullah was fortunate to be born in one such household. His father, as well as being a master of hadith, was a very successful, God-fearing, an honest businessman, to the extent that at the time of his death he was able to claim, لا أعلم من مالي درهما من حرام ولا درهما من شبهة. That Ismail, that in the wealth of Ismail, there is not a single penny of haram. There is not a single penny acquired from haram. There is not a single penny in anything which Ismail had doubt in whether it was haram or not. Who can make such a claim like this today? Who can say that from the day he was born till the day he died, every single penny was pure and halal? This was his father. His mother, like his father, was a very pious and God-fearing woman. It is related that the great Imam lost his eyesight in early childhood. The doctors at the time were unable to cure him. His mother constantly prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She knew Allah answers the prayer. One day in her dream she saw the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam saying to her, Ya hadihi qad radda Allahu ala ibnika basarahu bi kathrati du'aik. That Allah, because of your constant supplication, because of your constant praying and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah has answered your prayer and He has returned the eyesight of your child. She woke up and immediately went to her son Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari and found that he had regained his eyesight. This was the household Allah had chosen for this great Imam to be, Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari. Born on the 13th of Shawwal in 194 Hijri, his father died whilst he was still a child. Though at a disadvantage, this did not stop Imam Bukhari from becoming one of the greatest masters of hadith of all time. He memorized the Quran at a very, very early age. And we can safely assume that it was a very early age, as he himself says, ألهمت حفظ الحديث وأنا في الكتاب. That I was inspired to memorize the hadith of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم while I was still in the maktab, in the elementary school at the age of 10. It was the custom at the time that they memorized the Quran well before they began memorizing the hadith of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So we can safely assume that he had memorized the Quran well before the age of 10. He was a very special child, and his extraordinary ability and genius and brilliance began to show at a very early age. He left the elementary school at the age of 10 and began to attend the hadith circles of the great master of hadith, Al-Imam al-Daqili. At the age of 11, he corrected this great Imam, Al-Imam al-Dakhili himself. Imam al-Dakhili, teaching hadith like usual, one day made a mistake in relating the chain of the hadith. Imam al-Dakhili said, Sufyan an Abi Zubair an Ibrahim. Sufyan relates from Abu Zubair, and Abu Zubair relates from Ibrahim. Imam Bukhari said to him, Ya Aba Fulan, Inna Abu Zubair lam yarwi an Ibrahim. That Abu Zubair does not relate anything from Ibrahim. Imam al-Dakhili is shocked that somebody has spoken, seeing that it was a child. Maybe this child is fooling around. He reproached Imam Bukhari and told him off. Imam Bukhari said to him, If you do not believe me, irji ila al-asr in kana indak. Go and look at the original script if you still have it. Imam al-Dakhili went inside and looked at the original script. And he found it exactly like Imam Bukhari said, that Abu Zubair doesn't relate anything from Ibrahim. Now to test the great Imam himself, whether he actually knew the chain of the hadith, he asked him, oh little one, tell me how should it be? Imam Bukhari replied, it is Zubair, the son of Adi, that relates from Ibrahim. Imam Bukhari says that the great Imam took my pen and rectified his mistake. This was at the age of 11. He corrected the great master of hadith, Al-Imam al-Daqin. A step further. He's 16 years old. He says, حَفِظْتُ قُتَبَ مْنِ الْمُبَارَكِ وَوَكِيهِ وَعَرَفْتُ كَلَامَ هَؤُلَاءِ. That at the age of 16, I memorized all the books of Ibn al-Mubarak. I memorized all the books of Waqi. I memorized the fiqh of Abu Hanifa and everything relating to the fiqh of Abu Hanifa at the age of 16. We depart this world without even knowing how to recite the Quran, the book of Allah, as it should be recited. And this child is saying that at the age of 16, never mind memorizing the Quran, he has memorized all the books of Ibn al-Mubarak, all the books of Waqi, he has memorized the fiqh of Abu Hanifa and everything relating to the fiqh of Abu Hanifa. Such was his memory power that it is related, أَنَّهُ كَانَ يَنْظُرُ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرَّةً وَاحِدَةً فَيَحْفَظُهُ مِنْ نَظْرَةٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. He had a photographic memory. It is related that he would look inside a book once. He would read the entire book once, and by just reading the book once, he would remember everything from A to Z, everything that was written inside the book by just reading it once. He's still a child. He's attending the hadith circles of the Mashaykh of Basra, the masters of Basra. He's attending the hadith circles of the masters of Basra. The masters recite the hadith. They dictate the hadith. His companions write down the hadith. Imam Bukhari sits in one corner, listening attentively, but he does not write a single word. His companions, seeing this behavior, this frustrated them. That he attends the circles of hadith, he is sitting in front of the masters, yet he doesn't write a single word. They remain patient. They didn't say anything to him. Days passed. When they saw that this child has made a habit of it, he attends the circles day in, day out, but he sits in one corner, listens, and then leaves. Frustrated at his behavior, they said to him, oh Bukhari, why do you attend these circles if you are not going to write the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Imam Bukhari remained quiet and ignored them. Every day thereafter, they began to pester the great Imam. Why do you attend if you are not going to write the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Imam Bukhari yet again remained patient. One day, when they exceeded the limit, the child said, فَعْرِزُ عَلَيَّ مَا كَتَبْتُمْ. Show me what you have written over this period of time. Whatever he heard over this period of time, he had heard just once. As he did not write the hadith, he listened and he left the circle. Whatever he heard over this period of time, he heard once. My brothers and sisters, he related every single hadith and much more what he had heard over the period of the time. The narrator says the little child recited 15,000 hadith with the text and with the chain without a single mistake. 15,000 hadith without a single mistake. Now the masters of Baghdad, they have heard about this child. His reputation has grown day by day and his name has spread throughout the Islamic world. The masters of Baghdad have heard about Imam Bukhari. They've heard about his brilliance, his extraordinary memory power and his intellect. They remark, who is this Bukhari? Let us see who this Bukhari is. Let us see how much he knows. Let us see how much hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam he knows. We shall test him. It should be remembered that Baghdad at the time was the Darul Khilafah. It was the capital of the Islamic world. And it was Darul Ilm, the capital of all types of knowledge. It is related that at the time in Baghdad alone, at that time in Baghdad alone, there were 900 qualified doctors. We don't find 900 qualified doctors in one city today, in the 20th century. And at that time in Baghdad alone, it is related there were 900 qualified doctors, doctors with certificates. Though in those days, you did not need a certificate to prove that you were a doctor, and nor was it a habit of taking certificate. How many doctors do you think there were in total in Baghdad? If this was the situation of the worldly knowledge, how many masters of hadith do you think there were? How many fuqaha, masters of fiqh do you think there were? How many mutakallimi, masters of ilmul kalam? How many engineers do you think there were? This was the situation of Baghdad. The masters gathered and they decided to test Imam Bukhari. They took 100 hadith. They appointed 10 different people. They mixed the chains of the hadith and the text of the ahadith. These are the different chains of just one hadith. Different chains of just one hadith. They took 100 hadith like this and they changed the chains and they changed the text and they gave 10 hadith to each person. On the day of the examination, all the masters assembled. All the fuqaha, the masters of fiqh took their place. The masters of ilmul kalam took their place. The masters, the doctors, the engineers, thousands of people left their work and came to watch. The first person comes to Imam Bukhari and recites his first hadith. He asks Imam Bukhari, "Have you heard this hadith?" Imam Bukhari replies, "لا أعرفه." That this hadith is not known to me. He recites the second hadith. Yet again he asks the great Imam, "Do you know this hadith?" Imam Bukhari replies for the second time, "لا أعرفه." That this hadith is also not known to me. He recites the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, the seventh, the eighth, the ninth and the tenth hadith. Every time he asks Imam Bukhari, "Do you know this hadith?" But Imam Bukhari, after every hadith, replies, "La a'rifu," that these hadith are not known to Imam Bukhari. Those that knew that this was an examination, that this was a test, realized that the great Imam has understood the case. But the general opinion was that this Imam's knowledge is meager. He knows nothing. His memory is weak. The second comes and he recites his 10 hadith. After every hadith he asks the great Imam, "Do you know this hadith?" But yet again Imam, for all his 10 hadith, replies, "La a'rifu," that Bukhari does not know this hadith. The third comes, the fourth, the fifth, all 10 come and everyone recite their 10 hadith, but Imam Bukhari has one reply, that Imam Bukhari, "La a'rifu," doesn't know a single hadith out of these 100 hadith. Once they have all finished, from the audience Imam Bukhari calls the first. "Come." He calls the first and he says to him, "This is the hadith you recited. It was wrong. These are the mistakes you made in the chain. These are the mistakes you made in the text." He would point out the mistake and then he would recite the hadith correctly with the chain. He would say to him, "This is the second hadith that you recited unto me." He would point out the mistakes and recite the hadith correctly. He did this with each and every hadith. Every hadith, all 100 hadith, in the order they had recited them, with the mistakes they had recited them, he pointed out the mistakes and then recited each and every hadith correctly. For Imam Bukhari to have recited the 100 hadith correctly, that in itself itself was something special. But to have listened to these 100 hadith once, to have listened to these 100 hadith once, and to have remembered the order they had recited them, with the mistakes they had recited them, to remember these mistakes, and to pinpoint these mistakes, and to inform them of these mistakes, and then to recite the 100 hadith correctly, is well beyond. This was not the only examination. Now when the masters of Samarkand hear about this great imam, they also want to put this imam, they also want to test this great imam. Abu al-Azhar relates that in Samarkand 400 masters gathered and they decided to test this imam and take a mistake out of this imam. All the chains of the hadith, they mixed up. The chain of Sham, they put with the chain of Iraq. The chain of Iraq, they put with the chain of Yemen. The chain of Yemen, they put with the chain of Makkah. The chain of Makkah, with the chain of Medina. The chain of Medina, with the chain of Misr. The narrator says, not for one day. They gathered for 9 days, and they questioned Imam Bukhari. For 9 days. Questions after questions for 9 days, they questioned him. The narrator says they were not able to take a single mistake of the great imam. This was Imam Bukhari. He didn't just become a master overnight. We become masters overnight. 20 years, our school life begins at the age of 3. Nursery, first school, middle school, grammar, university. 20 years we have been taught, at least 20 years in the English language. Many of us have a great command over this language. But in spite of 20 years of being taught in this language, we still say that we cannot understand Shakespeare and his literature. 20 years of experience. We have passed our GCSEs. We have passed our A-levels. We have even got a degree in English. But there are certain pieces of Shakespeare we will say that we cannot understand these pieces. But on the other hand, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Quran, we don't even speak a word of Arabic. We've never studied Arabic. Though, it is not just Arabic that you require to understand the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Quran. There are many different sciences that one needs for him to be able to understand the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Quran. Surprising. We've mastered it overnight, without a single lesson. Yet on the other hand, 20 years of speaking English, and we say there are pieces of Shakespeare's literature that we do not understand, but when it comes to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Quran, overnight we have been inspired by Allah. And we know the meaning of a hadith and the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Bukhari didn't become a master overnight. The Quran says, it is common knowledge that to master anything in any field, sacrifice and commitment is required. The Quran itself says, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ صُبُلَنَا. We will surely guide those that strive hard, that sacrifice each and everything they possess. We shall surely guide these people. Imam Bukhari sacrificed each and everything he possessed for the sake of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to acquire this blessed knowledge. There was no such thing as rest. There was no such thing as working days and sleeping nights. Muhammad ibn Abi Hatim relates, كنت معه في كان أبو عبد الله إذا كنت معه في سفر يجمعنا بيت واحد إلا في القيد. That every time Imam Bukhari traveled for the sake of a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I Muhammad ibn Abi Hatim would go with Imam al-Bukhari and we would normally sleep in one room. He says, فَكُنْتُ أَرَاهُ يَكُونُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ وَاحِدَةٍ 15 مَرَةً إِلَى 20 مَرَةً that I would see this great imam in one night, this great imam would wake up 15 to 20 times. Every time the imam has woken up, he would light the lamp by flint. He would make mark on certain hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then the great imam would sleep, and he would do this in one night 15 to 20 times. In spite of inheriting a large amount of money, he himself a very successful businessman, but he sacrificed each and everything he possessed, each and every penny, on the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the extent that this great imam has to sell his clothes to acquire this blessed knowledge. It is narrated that once Imam Bukhari stopped attending the hadith circles, it was not his habit to miss a lecture or to not attend the hadith circles. His companions shocked at why the great imam is absent. They go to his house to visit him and they find that the great imam is only wearing pajamas. He is virtually naked. He has nothing to wear besides pajamas, my brothers and sisters, because he has sold his clothes for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was his companions that collected some money and bought some clothes and gave them to him. Days would go past, and Imam Bukhari says, I would live on leaves of wild plants, because Bukhari had no food to eat. He says, خَرَجْتُ إِلَىٰ آدَمَ مِنْ أَبِي إِيَاسٍ فَتَخَلَّفَتْ عَنِّي نَفَقَتِي حَتَّى جَعَلْتُ أَتَنَاوُلُ الْحَشِيشِ فَلَا أُخْبِرَ بِذَلِكَ أَحَدًا. That when I went to Adam ibn Abi Iyad, in one of my journeys to Adam ibn Abi Iyad, he says, my money ran out. I had no money, thus I wasn't able to purchase anything. He says, for 3 days I ate the leaves of wild plants because I had no food. He says, I never informed anybody. On the 3rd day, somebody came. I did not recognize who this person was. He gave me a bag of money and he said, Anfiq ala nafsik, O Bukhari, spend this on yourself. Such was his piety that in one of his journeys for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had a large amount of money with him. 1,000 dinars, 1,000 gold coins of that time. One of those aboard the ship came regularly and sat by Imam Bukhari and showed that he very much cared for him and very much loved him. Thus Imam Bukhari himself became inclined towards him. And after a few meetings, Imam Bukhari told him about the 1,000 dinars he has with him. One morning, this very same person wakes up, crying, shouting, ripping his clothes, slapping his face. Those aboard the ship, shocked at his behavior, asked him the reason for behaving in such a manner. He said that I had a bag containing 1,000 dinars and somebody has stolen this money. They began to search everybody on board the ship. Imam Bukhari took this 1,000 dinars and threw it inside the ocean. Everybody was searched, including Imam Bukhari. But this 1,000 dinars is not on board the ship. Thus they reproached this man for lying. As if he had 1,000 dinars, then it should be on the boat. But because they did not find it, they reproached this man for lying. When they disembarked, he came to Imam Bukhari and said, what did you do with the money? Imam Bukhari replied, أَلْقَيْتُهَا فِي الْبَحْرِ, that I threw it inside the ocean. Shocked, he asked, كَيْفَ صَبَرْتَ عَلَىٰ ضِيَاءِ هَذَا الْمَالِ الْعَظِيمِ, O Bukhari, because of me, you threw 1,000 dinars inside the ocean. You have made a great loss. Tell me, you are so calm. How have you managed to remain patient in spite of this great loss? You have not said anything to me. Imam Bukhari replied, Ya Jahil, أَلَا تَدْرِي أَنَّنِي أَفْنَيْتُ حَيَاتِي كُلَّهَا فِي جَمْعِ حَدِيثِ الرَّسُولِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَعَرَفَ الْعَالَمُ سِكَتِي فَكَيْفَ كَانَ يَنْبَغِي لِي أَنْ أَجْعَلَ نَفْسِي عُرْضَةً لِتُهْمَةِ السَّرِقَةِ. O Jahil, I have spent my life in compiling the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The world knows that Imam Bukhari is a sound narrator. The world knows that Imam Bukhari is trustworthy. How was it possible for Imam Bukhari to make himself a target for a false accusation of stealing? This wealth that I have acquired, this wealth of trustworthiness, siqa, adala, this wealth that I have acquired of trustworthiness, it took me a lifetime to acquire this wealth. Should Bukhari have wasted this wealth for a few dinar? A lifetime he spent for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters, no matter how clever a person is,